Hello, and welcome to Common Office 365 PowerShell Tasks. My name is John Horner. I'm a partner technical consultant with North America Partner Services, and I will be your facilitator for this presentation. Our agenda for today will be to go through the following modules, mixing PowerPoint slides with demonstrations of PowerShell in action. In Module 1, I will introduce Office 365 management with PowerShell and talk about the available commandlets to administer the Office 365 portal. Module 2 will introduce Exchange Online management with PowerShell and how we can leverage PowerShell to do such Exchange Online management tasks as creating and deleting mailboxes. In Module 3, we will talk about the newly available PowerShell management options for SharePoint Online. Module 4 will cover some of the partner capabilities and delegated administration of customers' tenants through PowerShell. And finally, we'll end the session with a quick look at some additional resources we can use to learn more about PowerShell in Office 365. As many of you may be aware, Windows PowerShell is a task-based command line shell and scripting language designed especially for system administration of on-premises server installations. What you may not have known is that we can use those same PowerShell skills to manage some of the Office 365 services. The objective of today's event is to introduce you to using PowerShell to manage some of the Office 365 services by getting you familiar with the requirements for managing Office 365 via PowerShell and familiar with the available commandlets and the syntax for using these commandlets. We will also talk about where we can find commandlets other than those expressly talked about today, as well as introduce you to the many resources available for you to refer to when using PowerShell to administer your Office 365 services. Okay, let's start by taking a look at portal management using PowerShell. As you will find out, the requirements for using PowerShell with Office 365 will vary depending on which services or part of Office 365 we want to administer via PowerShell. In Module 1, we will look at the requirements for portal management via PowerShell. Take a look at a few of the administrative tasks that can be performed via PowerShell for portal management, and I'll also introduce you to a tool called PowerShell Command Builder and discuss how we can use this tool to build various PowerShell commands by selecting the appropriate verb and noun from the tool's user interface. As mentioned earlier, the requirements for using PowerShell to manage the three areas we will talk about today each have their own specialties. To manage portal properties, such as users, passwords, and federation, the requirements are to download and install the Windows Azure Active Directory module for Windows PowerShell on either a Windows 7 or Windows 8 device, or a server operating system of Windows Server 2008 R2, or Windows Server 2012. We need to ensure that the .NET Framework 3.51 feature is installed on the machine that we select. And we also need to ensure that all required updates have been downloaded and applied, bearing in mind that some of the features of Office 365 may not function properly without the appropriate software or browser. Once we have a machine running one of the required operating systems, have installed all updates and the .NET Framework 3.51, we can go to the Microsoft Download Center and install the appropriate version of the Online Services Sign-In Assistant, either 32 or 64-bit depending on our operating system. Then we can navigate to the appropriate link and download the appropriate version of the Windows Azure Active Directory module for Windows PowerShell. Now that we have downloaded and installed the Windows Azure Active Directory module for Windows PowerShell, we are ready to launch PowerShell, connect to Office 365, and start using PowerShell to manage some of the features of the Office 365 portal. We have two options available to us to launch PowerShell for Office 365. First, we can click on the Start menu and select the Windows Azure Active Directory module for Windows PowerShell icon. Or if it does not show when selecting the Start menu, we can search for it using the All Programs menu. Secondly, we can simply launch PowerShell directly. If we launch PowerShell normally, We will need to import the MS Online module by typing import-module MS Online. Once we have PowerShell open by one of these two manners, we could then connect to the Microsoft Online service by typing connect-MSOL service. To complete the connection to online services, we will be prompted to enter our administrator credentials. Shown are just a few of the commandlets available for use when managing the Office 365 portal via PowerShell. Using PowerShell to manage a portal, we can do such things as create and delete users with commandlets like new MSOL user and remove MSOL user. We can retrieve user information by using the get MSOL user commandlet, which will retrieve a list of users. By using the user principal name parameter, we can retrieve an individual user's information. Using commandlets such as set MSOL user password and convert MSOL federated user, we can change the passwords of users or convert them to being a federated user, meaning they would authenticate to our company's internal Active Directory via Active Directory Federated Services. So let's take a look at the syntax for some of these PowerShell commands. If we wanted to use PowerShell to create a new user, we'd use the new-MSOL user commandlet, adding the parameters user principal name, display name, first name, and last name to set the UPN display name, first name, and last name of this user. If we want to set or change a password, we would use the set-MSOL user password commandlet, using the parameters of user principal name, new password, force change password. So this commandlet on the screen, we would change the password for the UPN john@contoso.onmicrosoft.com to being password. And by setting the force change password parameter to false, this user will not be forced to change their password when logging in with a new password. We can also use PowerShell to set a password policy. To set an individual user password policy, we would use the set MSOL user commandlet with the user principal name and password never expires parameters. This will set john@contoso.onmicrosoft.com's password to never expire. We could also pipe two commandlets together to be able to set our entire organization's passwords to never expire. So by using get-MSOL user and piping it with set-MSOL user and the password never expires parameter, setting that to true, we have now set all of our tenants' passwords to never expire. We can use PowerShell Command Builder to assist with building commands. You may notice from the screenshot that it says Windows PowerShell for SharePoint Command Builder. However, if we select Office 365 from the Products drop-down menu, we will be able to build commands for use when managing the portal as well. To build these commands, we select a verb, like noun or remove, for instance, and then select the appropriate noun, possibly MSOL user, which isn't visible in this screenshot, but we can use the slider bar to move on down to view other nouns. Parameters must then be populated, either required or optional. And we can copy the built command to a clipboard for use in PowerShell. We'll also notice that once we've selected a verb and noun combination, we will see an option to follow a link for further information on either the command we just built or about usage of the verb-noun combination we have selected. Now let's take a quick look at PowerShell in action. And take a look at portal management with PowerShell by connecting to the Microsoft Online Services. We'll create a new user. We'll set a password policy. Then we'll also take a look at the PowerShell Command Builder for Office 365. Before we connect to online services to create a new user, let's quickly go into the portal and verify that the user does not exist. So here is my portal. If I click on Users and Groups, we'll see that I'm going to create a user named A User that does not currently exist. Okay, so now let's connect to PowerShell. Open PowerShell. And as we said earlier, if we open regular PowerShell, we need to import the MS Online module. So we type import module MSN line. We also want to connect to the MSOL service. So we type this will prompt us for our credentials where we can enter our administrator credentials. Wait for that to come up. And now we can see that we are connected. So we've already verified that we don't have a user named a user, but we've already talked about and mentioned the PowerShell command builder. So let's quickly take a look at that. So here's PowerShell command builder. Like I said, if we select SharePoint Online, there's going to be different options, SharePoint Foundation, but if we select Office 365, we'll see the listing of verbs that we can use, as well as the listing of nouns that we have available for us. So to create a new user, we could use the new command and drag it into the verb area, and the MSOL user command and bring it into the noun area. And let us know that we have two required parameters we have to enter. So our first parameter is the display name, and the second parameter is the user principal name. We also have several optional commands that we can use. I want to set a first name and a last name for us, so we'll scroll down in the optional commands, and let's set the first name as just the initial A, and let's set the last name to be user. We can see this command now has been built out for us, and we can copy it to a clipboard. We could also click here to get more information about this and the see also command. So if we were to open see also, I'll open it in a new tab. We can see that this is kind of moved to a TechNet library that we can follow along to, and we'll see the TechNet library. This has all of the available commandlets to use with Windows Azure Active Directory. We have some content, so in install required software, etc. And as we scroll down, we'll see that we have in groups, manage users, manage groups and role membership, etc. So this is where we can find more information about the commands that we're going to use. Back on PowerShell Command Builder, we have the ability to copy this to a clipboard. So if I select copy to clipboard and then open PowerShell back up, I can paste that command right into PowerShell. Select enter, and it will run that command for us. We can see it came back that we did create a user principal name of a user at hornerdemo.microsoft.com, display name of a user, gave us a password, which I will note down. And we can see that the user is currently not licensed. So to verify the user's creation, let's go back to the portal and refresh the user page. And we can see that a user has now been created. If I select a user, I'll then have the ability to go ahead and assign licenses to that user. And select the user's location. And the user has been created and now assigned a license. Now, if we want to change a user's password or a user named a user, we can use set-msolpassword, use the user principal name parameter, new password equals pass at word one, and force password change equal false, meaning we will not force this user to change their password at login. So we can see that the new password has been changed. We can also use PowerShell if we'd like to. We can change the password policy on this user so this user's password will never expire by using set MSOL user, user principal name, and password never expires true. So now our user named A user's password will never expire. If we'd like to, as we mentioned in the slide deck, we could pipe a couple commands together and we could set the password never expires parameter for our entire tenancy by using get MSOL user pipe set MSOL user password never expires true. By hitting enter, waiting for this command to complete, we have now set all users' passwords in this tenancy to never expire. As I mentioned a little earlier in this demo, by navigating to TechNet, we can find all the information about Windows Azure Active Directory, PowerShell. If we scroll down on this page, we can see that we have different commandlets for managing users via PowerShell. We have commandlets for managing group and role membership via PowerShell. We have commandlets for managing service principals by PowerShell, as well as managing domains, managing single sign-on, managing subscription and licenses, and managing company information and service. So we just saw PowerShell in action. We saw a few commandlets being used to manage some of the portal properties within Office 365, and we took a look at the PowerShell command builder. For further information on commandlets available to manage portal properties such as group and role membership, company information, or single sign-on, please refer to the TechNet article link currently on the screen. As I mentioned at the start of Module 1, the requirements for using PowerShell with Office 365 will vary depending on which services or which part of Office 365 we want to administer via PowerShell. In Module 2, we'll take a look at the requirements for PowerShell when it comes to managing Exchange Online and how to create and import a PowerShell session for Exchange Online management. We'll also take a look at a few of the administrative tasks that can be performed via PowerShell in Exchange Online. And I'll talk a little bit about how commandlets become available to run in the remote run space once we connect to Exchange Online and import a PowerShell session. Before we can use Windows PowerShell to manage Exchange Online, we must make sure we have the correct version of Windows PowerShell and Windows Remote Management installed and configured on our computer. We have to use the Windows Management Framework, which contains the correct versions of Windows PowerShell V2 and WinRM 2.0 that applies to our operating system, system architecture, and language. If our computer is running Windows 7, Windows Server 2008 R2, Windows 8, or Server 2012, we won't have to install anything. The Windows Management Framework is already there. If we are running an earlier but still supported operating system, before we can install the Windows Management Framework 2.0, we must uninstall any existing versions of Windows PowerShell and uninstall any previous versions of the Windows Management Framework. It's important to note here that if our local computer is protected by a Microsoft Internet Security and Acceleration Server or ISA server, we may have to install the Windows Firewall client or configure a proxy server on our local computer to connect Windows PowerShell to the cloud-based service. We must run PowerShell as an administrator and check the execution policy by running get-execution policy. If the value returned is anything other than remote signed, we need to change the value to remote signed by running set-execution policy remote signed. Another thing to note here is that when we set the script execution policy to remote signed, we can only run scripts that we create on our computer or scripts that are signed by a trusted source. As many of you may be aware, Office 365 and Exchange Online use role-based access control, or RBAC, to determine what users have what permissions within Exchange Online. So how does this transfer to remote PowerShell when we want to administer Exchange Online via PowerShell? By default, Eric, in his client run space, will have the only command available to him to run will be new PS session. So by creating a new PS session, we're going to authenticate and authorize Eric at the remote server. The remote server looks at Eric's role-based access control and determines that he has permissions to run new mailbox, get mailbox, set mailbox with the name parameter. PowerShell will make those commandlets available in the run space and return them to the remote run space to make them available for Eric to run, thus allowing Eric to run the new mailbox name Bob commandlet to create a new mailbox for Bob in the server run space and will return the mailbox object in the pipeline. So how do we get connected to Exchange Online via PowerShell? Of course, we'll need to launch PowerShell using Run as Administrator. Our suggestion is to store credentials in a variable by typing $cred. $cred is the variable. If we use $cred equal get credential, we'll get prompted for our user admin credentials again. We can then use this credential variable when creating a variable that's going to hold our PS session. So our suggestion is to use the $session, or we could use whatever we'd like, $exchange session, etc., something like that. Set that variable equal to new PS session with the configuration name Microsoft.exchange, the connection URI https://ps.outlook.com/PowerShell. Our credential will be that $credential variable. Set our authentication parameter to basic. And we also want to allow redirection. This is what allows all Exchange Online tenants, no matter where they're at in the world, to connect to their specific tenant via one URL. We'll be redirected to our Exchange Online tenant. Then to download the Exchange Online PowerShell commandlets or import the session, we simply type import-ps session, $session. This will allow us to run all of the commandlets to manage Exchange Online via PowerShell. And once we're done, we can stop or remove the session by typing remove PS session, $session. It's very important to note that not all of the PowerShell commandlets used to manage an Exchange on-premises installation will be available in Exchange Online PowerShell management. And the ones that are will behave a little differently between Exchange on-premises and Exchange Online. Another trick we wanted to share with you that can be useful is to use yet another variable, something like $exol session, and set that variable equal to the imported PS session. This will allow us to use that variable to find useful information like the count of commandlets ran or get a list of commands. Here are just a few of the commandlets available for use when managing Exchange Online via PowerShell. Using PowerShell to manage Exchange Online, we can do such things as create and delete mailboxes with commandlets like new mailbox and remove mailbox. We can also retrieve mailbox information by using the get mailbox commandlet, or change existing mailbox settings by using the set mailbox commandlet. We can create a new mailbox by using the new mailbox commandlet, adding parameters like name, Microsoft Online Services ID, and password. We can retrieve such things as mailbox login statistics by piping two commandlets together, such as get mailbox and get mailbox statistics. This will get us statistics for all mailboxes in our organization. We can delete a user's mailbox by using the remove mailbox commandlet and adding a parameter to indicate which mailbox to delete, such as Jane Doe. It's important to note that we must keep Jane Doe in quotation marks. We can also restore a previous deleted mailbox by again using the new mailbox commandlet, but using a slightly different set of parameters. We can pipe retrieved information to a CSV file by using export-CSV, and indicating an export path for that file. Sessions will time out after 15 minutes of inactivity. However, if we issue another command after the session timeout, we can reconnect easily by reauthenticating at the prompt. Now let's take a look at Exchange Online management with PowerShell. We'll connect to Exchange Online and create a session. We'll create a new mailbox. And then we'll also remove or delete a mailbox and restore that mailbox. To manage Exchange Online via PowerShell, we want to launch PowerShell, verify the execution policy is remote signed. We are set to be remote signed. If it wasn't, we could use the set execution policy remote signed command to set our execution policy to be remote signed. As mentioned in the slide deck, to make things easier, we want to declare a variable called $cred or whatever you'd like to call it. Just precede it with a dollar sign. It'll make it a variable. Equal to get credential, which will prompt us for our administrative credentials. And as mentioned in the slide deck, we want to create another variable called $session to help us connect and import a PS session. So we type $session equal new PS session. We use the configuration name of Microsoft.exchange, connection URI of http://ps.outlook.com/powershell. Here's where the credential variable comes in, so we don't have to enter those credentials again. Our credential equal to creds. We want to have our authentication be basic, and we want to allow redirection. So now we have been redirected to the following URI, where we can now go ahead and import our PS session. We can see now that the session is being imported. And we are now able to administer Exchange Online via PowerShell. Before we create a new mailbox, let's navigate to the Exchange Online Admin Center and verify that we do not have a mailbox for user John Doe. Create this mailbox, we use the new mailbox commandlet with the parameters of name, Microsoft Online Services ID, and password. A warning pops up letting us know that after we create a new mailbox, we must go to the Office 365 Admin Center and assign the mailbox a license, or it will be disabled after the grace period. So now let's navigate back the Exchange Online control panel. There still is no John Doe user, but let's refresh and see if the mailbox shows up. And there it shows up. We have the mailbox for John Doe created. If we want to take a look at some mailbox logon statistics, we can pipe two commands together using get mailbox and get mailbox statistics. Here we can see the commands have ran, and we can see that John Doe has never logged in before. For more Exchange Online PowerShell management options, we can navigate to help.outlook.com, where we'll find a quick listing of the available areas of management. And as we scroll down, we'll see commandlets for mailbox management, distribution group management, dynamic distribution group management, and so forth. Unlike with portal management, and as we'll see in a moment with SharePoint Online management, there is no PowerShell command builder available for Exchange Online. For further information on available PowerShell commandlets to manage such things as recipient management, Exchange Active Sync, and domains, please see the help.outlook.com article referred to in the link at the bottom of the screen. Just like with portal management and Exchange Online management through PowerShell, SharePoint Online has its own set of requirements for management via PowerShell. In Module 3, we'll take a look at the requirements for PowerShell when it comes to managing SharePoint Online and how to connect PowerShell to the online service. We'll also take a look at a few of the administrative tasks that can be formed via PowerShell and SharePoint Online, where we can find a list of other available PowerShell commandlets, and once again take a look at the PowerShell command builder. To manage SharePoint Online via PowerShell, we will need to download and install Windows PowerShell 3.0. The link on the screen currently is where we can download that from. We want to make sure we review the system requirements section before we install Windows Management Framework 3.0, as some server applications are not yet compatible with Windows Management Framework 3.0. Also, we must install the SharePoint Online Management Shell, making sure to select the appropriate 32 or 64-bit version. And to run SharePoint Online Management Shell commandlets, we must be an Office 365 SharePoint Online Global Administrator. To connect to SharePoint Online via PowerShell, navigate to the SharePoint Online Management Shell by selecting the Start menu and All Programs if necessary. Make sure we run SharePoint Online Management Shell as an administrator. Once we have the management shell open, we can connect by running connect-spo service. The URL should be the URL of the administration center of our tenancy, and the credential should be a Office 365 SharePoint Online Global Administrator. Here are a few of the commandlets available for use when managing SharePoint Online via PowerShell. Using PowerShell to manage SharePoint Online, we can do such things as create and delete site collections with commandlets like new SBO site and remove SBO site. It's important to note that removed or deleted site collections will be sent to the recycle bin, where they can be restored if necessary by using restore SBO deleted site for up to 30 days from the time of deletion. We can retrieve site collection information such as owner and storage quota by using the get SBO site commandlet. To get a listing of all site collections for our tenant, including site collection owner and storage quota, we can run get SBO site. To get the same information for a single site collection, we can add the identity parameter. And if we want to create new site collection using PowerShell, we can do so by using the new SBO site commandlet. As you may notice by the screenshot, this is the exact same PowerShell command builder we looked at back in the portal administration module. When we select SharePoint Online from the products drop-down menu, we see the available verbs and nouns for SharePoint Online PowerShell commands. To build commands, we again select a verb like new or remove, and then select the appropriate noun like SBO site, for instance. Just like before, some of these nouns are not visible in this screenshot, but we can use the slider bar to move on to view other nouns. Again, we can populate the parameters, either required or optional, and copy the built command to a clipboard for use in PowerShell. Once we have selected a verb and noun, we will see an option to follow a link for further information on either the command we just built or about the usage of the verb-noun combination. Now let's take a look at SharePoint Online management with PowerShell. We'll connect to SharePoint Online. We'll create a site collection, delete, restore a site collection, and take a look at the PowerShell command builder for SharePoint Online. for SharePoint online management via PowerShell, as we alluded to in the slide deck. We want to open the SharePoint online management shell as an administrator, which I forgot to do there. So I'll quickly go back in and run that as an administrator. SharePoint Online Management Shell is open. Let's kind of slide that down a little bit so we can make it a little bit bigger to utilize. First thing we want to do is we'll want to connect to the online service. And I want to connect to the proper service, so let me put in my credential for admin at .onmicrosoft.com. It'll ask me for my password. Give it a little time to connect, and there we are connected. So if we want to get a listing of current SharePoint sites, we can run the get SBO site command. Give me a listing of my current SharePoint sites, who the owner of that site is, and the current storage quota for that site. Just like we did in portal management, we can use the PowerShell command builder for SharePoint. By selecting from the products, we select SharePoint Online. We can see the available verbs and nouns. So if we want to maybe create a new site collection, we could use the new verb with the site noun. We'll find the required parameters of URL owner and storage quota. So let's put in the URL. The owner will be our admin user. And we'll give it a 1,000 megabyte storage quota. Now we have an option of compatibility level, locale ID, no weight, resource quota, template, zone ID, etc., title. We can give it a title here of the new demo site. So now we see the PowerShell command let built there. We will copy it to clipboard. Come back to PowerShell and paste our commandlet in there, new SBO site, the URL. We've got into URL that we want it to have. The owner is going to be the admin, storage quota is going to be 1,000, and the title will be new demo site. By selecting enter, we will start creating. While we're waiting for that to create, let's go to our manage site collections, and we'll see that I do not have anything called /sites/demo. Site. Let's refresh, and it actually should probably appear with a spinning wheel letting us know that it is being created. There we go. The new demo site is now being created. We can go back to PowerShell and wait for this to finish. One thing of note, you'll see that we did not specify a template when we were creating the site. So by not specifying a template, we're creating a blank SharePoint site collection that when we go to navigate to it for the first time, it will ask us to pick a template. So let's give it a little time to complete. We'll move this over so we can see the wheel spinning, as well as we have not received our prompt yet. Let's Let's go back and refresh this page once real quickly to make sure it's still spinning. Looks like it has not been created yet. We'll continue to wait. Matter of fact, let's not continue to wait. I have a site here that I created earlier using the same thing. If we click on it, we'll be able to navigate to that site, and I'll show you that we do not have a template currently assigned. If we had a template we wanted to use, we could upload it to the solution gallery here by clicking on solution gallery, and we could upload it. If we go back and wanted to create it as a team site, we would simply leave it as a team site. We have enterprise and publishing sites available as well. We'll just come back and click OK, and it will continue creating our SharePoint site using the team site template. And there we can see that it has finished creating that new demo site, and we'd be able to do the same thing that we're doing on this site here. If we go back to Command Builder, once again we can see the See Also link. If we were to click on that and follow, it would give us information about the new SBO site, give us some information about the parameters that we can use when creating a new site, and give us some examples of the code that we could use, or the syntax we can use to create a new site. As you can see down here, we have a couple that are using templates. We have template names and numbers for the site collection templates, so if you know the number, we can certainly add that in. You can see in this little area that the language is set to English United States, so that would be 1033 for the locale ID. We can certainly set all of those, the time zone parameter, etc. We can set all of those via PowerShell, so that when we create the site, the template will be there, the language will be set, and everything will be ready for us to go. Again, back to PowerShell Command Builder, we can see that we can clear our design. We can do things like add user. Again, we'd have to enter the site login name and group name. It'll give us the command down here. If we wanted to remove possibly a site or delete a site, we can give it the identity, optional confirm yes or no wait, etc. So PowerShell Command Builder for SharePoint Online is extremely useful. I would suggest everyone to go out and take a look at it, play around with different things to get used to using PowerShell to manage SharePoint Online. As with the other demos today, this was only a quick look at a few of the commands available for managing SharePoint Online via PowerShell. We can find other commandlets at the TechNet article listed on the screen, or by using SharePoint Online PowerShell Command Builder. In Module 4, we'll quickly take a look at the partner capabilities for delegated administration via PowerShell. Just like delegated administration through the user interface, if the customer has accepted the delegated administration offer, partners with delegated administration access to tenants can use PowerShell to administer on behalf of the customer without needing admin credentials from that tenant. You may have noticed that there is no section on administering Link Online via PowerShell. PowerShell administration is not currently supported for Link Online. Similarly, delegated administration of SharePoint Online is not currently supported via PowerShell. As a delegated administrator, we have the ability to search for partner contracts via PowerShell. If the tenant has accepted our delegated administration offer, we can retrieve that contract or tenant ID by using get-MSOL partner contract with the parameter -domain name and contoso.onmicrosoft.com or whatever domain we're looking for. This will return the partner contract in what will resemble a globally unique identifier or GUID by setting a variable equal to the tenant ID that was returned. We can run the portal administration PowerShell command to administer on behalf of the tenant. Similarly, if we want to manage a tenant's exchange online via PowerShell, we can use a delegated org variable to connect to the proper tenant. In the command on screen, $session equals new PS session, configuration name, Microsoft.exchange, connection URI, ps.outlook.com, PowerShell, and here's where we throw in the delegated org. So delegated org equal the domain that we're wanting to manage. The credentials would be our credentials of the partner's administration. And then we again want to use basic authentication and allow redirection. It's important to note that just like when managing our own tenant, we must continue the connection process. For portal management, we'll need to use the import module MS Online and connect MSOL service. And for Exchange Online management, we'll need to use the import PS session $session. To summarize, today we talked about using PowerShell to administer different Office 365 services. We discussed how the process to connect PowerShell is different for each service and talked about a few of the commandlets available to administer each service. We also talked a little about the partner capabilities for using PowerShell to administer on behalf of those tenants that have accepted our delegated administration offers, and that PowerShell administration is currently not supported for Link Online, nor is it currently supported to administer SharePoint Online on behalf of a customer via delegated administration. Please feel free to pause the presentation if you need a little more time to write down any of these links. But some great resources are the Windows PowerShell Getting Started Guide and the Manage Windows Azure Active Directory Guide for using Windows PowerShell. Please take the moment to check those out. I've talked about the PowerShell Command Builder tool a few times today. There's also a blog available, so please check out the Office 365 PowerShell Command Builder blog. Besides a link to the reference to available PowerShell commandlets in Exchange Online on the screen, there are some great TechNet videos out there. Please feel free to go up to TechNet to watch those, as well as TechNet has some great information on hybrid deployments. And there is the Windows PowerShell for SharePoint Online reference available at the TechNet URL listed on the slide as well. Please feel free to reach out to Partner Services if you have any questions, comments, or concerns about today's presentation. You can reach us in the portal at http://aka.ms.mpnsupport. You can also reach us in support communities at http://aka.ms/support communities, or email us directly at askpts@microsoft.com. This has been PowerShell for Common Office 365 Tasks, brought to you by the Microsoft Partner Network. My name again is John Horner, and I am a partner technical consultant with North America Partner Services. Thank you for viewing today's session, and I hope you have a wonderful rest of your day.